Welcome to Classic Album Sundays, our weekly deep dive into a classic album selected by a new guest every week and funded by Arts Council England, so thank you to them. I'm super excited by today's guest, as they're one of my favourite discoveries of recent years. We're joined by Travis Alabanza, an artist, performer and playwright that I first became aware of after being recommended Burgers, the play they directed and performed, which dismantled the process of making a burger and compared it with the trans experience. It was the most poignant, illuminating, moving and wonderful hour of theatre I've ever experienced, and I've followed their work keenly ever since. They chose Lianne La Havas' debut album, Is Your Love Big Enough, as their classic album, which we'll explore today. Lianne La Havas is a South London singer-songwriter creating soulful alternative folk music, and Is Your Love Big Enough was released in 2012. So firstly, welcome Travis, hello.
Hi, oh my God, what an intro. I had no idea that that is what you're thinking about my work. So thanks so much, that's so lovely.
I can't even like, that's, you know, I hope you can tell this is fully from the heart. I went to see that on a recommendation and I remember looking in London, couldn't get any tickets, but I happened to be in Edinburgh while Burgers was showing, and I literally camped out in the morning. I got my little seat, was in the returns queue being like, get a ticket, get a ticket, get a ticket, and my emails in the returns queue for 3 hours, got a ticket, and it was absolutely the best thing I've ever seen in my life, and thank you so much for it. It was wonderful.
Oh my God, amazing. I would walk past the people in the returns queue when I was going to my dressing room and they'd look at my eyes and I'd be like, I don't know how long you've been there, but good luck. So I'm glad. Look at this. The best people are always in the returns queue.
It's true. How are you doing? I mean, it's a huge question, but how has your pandemic been, essentially?
Which one? Do you know what I mean? I feel like we've had like 7 million transformations in a space of a year. Lockdown three is difficult. Definitely this one's without as much bolstered and cheer as a year ago. But I'm getting there, you know. I'm lucky. I'm with friends and I'm in a safe place. So, you know, I can't complain as much. How about you?
I think, you know, echoing what you said, it seems to be like many, many different stages to it. Sometimes you're like, oh, I'm processing this and learning so much about myself. And other times you're like, how am I going to get through this? You know, it just seems to be so many different phases.
Yeah, definitely. I'm dreaming of the clubs. That's where I am now. I'm just dreaming of when the clubs can open safely.
Okay, I absolutely, yeah. Same here, hopefully soon. How has creating been in this time? I think for, you know, people that A, enjoy, and B, find solace and community in clubs. This has been, I found it hard to create at times. And I wonder how that has been for you. I mean, have you been inspired? Have you felt it within you to be able to create at this time?
It's been really hard, like, if I'm honest. I think that, like, if someone told me, like, 4 years ago, there's going to be a global pandemic, this is going to happen, I would have predicted that I would be someone that would have like created loads of content, made loads of stuff online, be like entertaining, turning YouTube live shows, Instagram lives, all of that. I think I thought that would be me. But what I found is that actually I've been really quiet, or wanting to be really quiet this year. I haven't felt as inspired. Obviously I have made stuff, you know, I made a show, Overflow, that came out during the last year. But it was a real push to like get the creativity to do it, because I think I'm inspired by people and I'm inspired by situations and other performers. Otherwise, it's just in my head. And so it's hard to not be around the liveness of like the world, I think. Yeah, I've struggled. But I do think that it's given the positive to end, like to try and turn it into a positive. I would say that it's made me so much more clear of my decisions. I think sometimes when you're working as a freelancer pre-pandemic, you don't get to stop and think about every decision. Whereas like we are left with our own decisions all the time now. So I can feel really clear on like my decisions and what I do. And so hopefully when I feel more in a world that feels recognizable, I'll go into it a bit clearer, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I totally see that, because, you know, things are so fast normally that you're sort of like on the road doing things while you're also getting emails in or having your agent call you. And at the moment, you know, there's that space to really kind of, everything's under the magnifying glass in a way.
Yeah, so true. Like every decision. So now I just, instead I'm like, okay, well, I would normally be going to a bar before I reply back to this email. Instead, I'll just take a nap. So now I just punctuate my days with naps.
Which is wonderful. Awesome. How has, I mean, music been for you during this time? Like, have you been listening to anything different? Like, have you been listening to music?
Yeah, I feel like it's been really interesting. Like, this time, like, in my home, I feel like I've been able to appreciate albums more from start to finish and give them, like, a whole listen through without stopping it to go and do something or being on a tube or like texting or whatever. I feel like I've had a few albums that have came out in this period. The ones that spring to mind, like off the top of my head, obviously when Chromatica came out during this time, like it felt like because nothing else had happened ever, we were like really could dive into it and appreciate it. I'm also thinking of KJ Pearson's EP came out called The Return. She's like a Southwest based like folk pop artist, I guess. And I wouldn't normally listen to like loads of that now in my day to day. But because I was sat in my bed, I was like, this is the perfect time to listen to like something a bit slower or whatever. So yeah, I feel like album deep diving. That's why I loved this offer. I was like, album deep diving has been the vibe this year, I think.
Your selection today is Lianne La Havas's debut album, Is Your Love Big Enough? Can you tell me about when you first came across Lianne La Havas as an artist? Well,
I think she was performing on Jules Holland, and I think she was doing the debut from this album, Forget, like the kind of hit or the lead single from this album. She was definitely on Jules Holland, and I remember seeing her and just being like, oh, this is right up my street. Like, this is exactly the kind of music I'm into. I love like singer-songwriters. I love people that I love front women that are playing instruments. You know, I just love like kind of pop with a bit of a band to it and stuff. It's like all my kind of style. So yeah, I saw her first on Jules Holland and was a bit obsessed.
And what was it? So I mean, you say you love front women and that kind of like blend of, because I mean, I listened to it and I have to say I knew some of the songs, but I hadn't listened to the album in full, and it's really nurturing. I found it just really, really like, I felt like it really fed my soul. You know, it was a really beautiful listen. And, you know, she's clearly a very talented woman. And I liked her sort of like kind of alternate view on things. It definitely seemed like a sort of like alternate kind of folk record.
Yeah. Like, I think I have two, like, well, more than two, but like I have like, with music, I've got the stuff that I need to listen to when I'm on a night out or when I'm clubbing and da-da-da, when I'm at work getting myself geared up. That's very different. And the music I like out in the clubs. But when I'm on my own or like I travel a lot for work, I need stuff that's quite, I like storytelling because I don't want to necessarily read or listen to like an audiobook, but I want music that has this kind of storytelling like aspect to it. And definitely stuff that you can like calm yourself to, I think. And that's what kind of drew me to her. Like, I think her voice is like really soothing. I think it's like really, she's got a really powerful voice, beautiful voice. But I think that her songs are also like, they're telling stories, you know, like she's clearly about the lyrics. And that's what attracts me to her. And I think then, I think I listened to her first on Juice Holland, and then I kind of like was like, oh, she's cool. Like, I'm going to like put her as like someone that I'll listen to again. And then I bought the album, and because I was like, you know what, I'm not going to stream it, I'm going to buy it, because like I was like, you know what, like black artists, black musician making work. And I first listened, I didn't listen to it the whole way through, and then I went for a breakup. And whenever you go for a breakup,
you need those records.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like, you know, certain albums punctuate like your breakup or your love or whatever. And Forget, I was like, I think I need to listen to Forget on that album. And it was a good breakup that moment for me.
So that was maybe 8 years ago. Is it still just one of those albums that you keep going back to?
Oh my God, yeah. I mean, all of her work really, to be honest. And she also released her work, I think in the last, I don't know, my concept of time is gone, but she had a recent album out that I feel like I listened to properly in lockdown, and I think it came out in the last year, not sure. But yeah, I've returned to it. Like, it's my, you know, when I was asked the question of like, what's an album, like, what's your favourite album? It's so hard because I've got, you know, so many different albums. But I was like, what counts as a favourite album? I think it's one that you can put on and you won't skip really any tracks, and that it's lasted your growth and you still want to listen to it and you still want to hear it. And it was hard because like there were certain iconic, you know, maybe more like classic iconic albums that I could have went to, but they developed skips over time, or like there were some I wasn't feeling as much anymore. Whereas this album, no matter what, when I put it on, I can listen to every single song and like be transported somewhere. So yeah, I properly listened to it again for this, and I was like in love with it all over again. And like all of her, some of the songs, my favourites on the album are on my shuffle and stuff.
It's like the ultimate companionship, isn't it? It's like, it's always there when you need it.
Yeah, and you can kind of track, like, I don't know about you, but for me, when I listen to certain songs, I picture like a certain moment of exactly where I was when I was listening to it the last time. And that for me is like a good album, when it's like got that for you. Like there's certain albums that you listen to and you go, I remember when I was there at this age feeling this, and now I'm here.
Yeah. Now, have you ever had the opportunity to see her perform live?
Yes, I saw a festival and I wanted to remember which one. But I was performing at, okay, so it was either, she was either at Secret Garden Pie when I saw her, or she was at Latitude. And I want to say it was Latitude. I know she was at both, but I saw her at one.
Because yeah.
I remember being programmed to, you know, I was performing at both of the festivals, and I just remember being like, I hope that we're not programmed at the same, we're like, please, can I?
No! Because
it had happened before with Latitude. They're always putting me on like later in the evening at one of the other tents. But obviously that's not like the main, you know, I'm not a musician. So I'm always like, but if you put me on late in this poetry tent, it means I'm going to clash with like the headline music act. Stop. And I ran.
Oh, such a good slot.
Yeah. I'm like, no, put me in the morning so I can go and see whatever. But I went to go and see Lianne La Havas at Latitude. I'm going to say, but I caught like the back of, I was at the back of the crowd, but I still got to see her and like hear the songs, and you know, she's there playing the guitar, effortlessly cool. I think, you know, she's really cool, you know.
You've got some beautiful looks. I kind of watched a few videos of her and I was like, wow, she's pretty phenomenal, you know.
Yeah, the style, the like coolness, effortless kind of vibe to it. You know, like you've seen Burgers, I care about aesthetic, you know, I love fashion and visuals. And I love that even though hers isn't necessarily like in bold in some of the ways that like pop, you know, classic pop would be, you know, she's still, her aesthetic's crisp. I love it. Really cool.
I've seen Burgers, I've seen your Instagram, and I'm like, wow. I've got to, you know, up my game basically.
Well, like, yeah. We have to say, for the record of people seeing this now, I did think this was audio only. So this is me on a casual audio only day.
Great. You feel it, great. Yeah. I have to say, when I did ask, I, as the huge Travis Alabanza fan I am, I did go and see Overflow. I managed to see it on the, I'm not even embarrassed about how much of a fan I am. I actually managed to get tickets and see it on the last night before it shut.
Oh my God.
Actually. Yeah, so I mean that obviously must also be difficult, seeing that, you know, you would have put so much work into performance, but I did feel very lucky. It was literally the last night before. Wow. It was like all done. And I mean, Overflow is incredible. You know, maybe I should let you explain it, because you'll obviously be able to explain your own art better than I shall. But I think one thing that I really resonated with was the sort of sanctity of the Loos, basically, during a clubbing experience, during a night out. That is where a lot of the magic happens. That is where a lot of our sisterhood is formed, and where we congregate and where we have a beautiful time, basically. And really, I think, make those lasting memories and friendships. And also, you know, it's, the backdrop is a club. Basically,
yeah.
I was half expecting you to choose you know, a club record. But how does that also work into like your listenings and what you're passionate about musically?
Yeah, do you know, I think I love club music, and I love, like, you know, growing up in Bristol with such a great music scene around me, but also going clubbing from quite an early age in Bristol. Sorry, Mum, if you're watching this.
Sorry to all the mums.
Yeah, sorry to all, yeah, definitely. But, you know, I think that, like, the reason, maybe, again, it's about, like, what I listen to when I relax. And I think that, like, I love clubbing, and I love house music. I love, like, great, like, US rap. I love black queer music. Like, for me, the soundtrack for Overflow, the soundtrack that I wanted, and then, you know, it depends what you can get royalties for, but the stuff that I put on the playlist as the inspiration was, like, Mickey Blanco, Cakes to Killer, Azealia Banks, you know, all these people that, for me, create, like, a good house pop, like rap above it, you know, Cupcake, all these kind of people I love. But when I was growing up, I guess, you know, I'm not that old, so, like, it's a millennial kind of vibe, but you'd go into the clubs and you'd, like, rejoice when KEB came on. I remember when it was KEB on a Mission, or KEB's collab with Miss Dynamite. That was, like, you know, the one in the clubs at the time when that would go on, you'd be like, this is the coolest moment ever. But also, I guess in Bristol, I like, Mungo Hi-Fi used to play a lot all the time in Bristol. So, you know, like, kind of reggae, dub, that kind of vibes as well. So yeah, I have quite an eclectic music taste, I would say, which I feel like everyone says, but, like, it depends what mood I'm in. But when I'm at home, it's very different. Like, when I'm at home, I only really like to listen to, like, soul, folk, chilling out. But in the clubs, it's a different kind of story, you know?
Yeah, for sure. And are you in London at the moment? Is London where you're currently located? Well, living?
No, I was one of the London expats going away back to Bristol. So I'm actually back in Bristol after lockdown one. So I didn't get to, I wasn't there for the Overflows last night, which was sad. Yeah, I'm back in Bristol because I just wanted to be somewhere during this time that felt like home and is home, you know, to me.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I mean, do you know what's going to happen with Overflow? Obviously, it's so difficult when, you know, so much work is going put into, like, a theatre run like that. And obviously it comes to an abrupt short, which I know lots of people are facing in all kinds of different, many different industries, but especially creative industries.
Yeah, I think, you know, what was kind of Overflow, like, for me, when they offered us to do it, I kind of didn't ever expect us to get any live show on it, because I wasn't really believing that. We got asked to do it during, you know, that COVID break, and I kind of was like, I don't think we're going to get a live show out of it. So I kind of went into it with a maybe feeling like it might have a stop. But we had the online viewing, which was great, because it meant that other people could see it globally and stuff like that. And I don't think it's going to come back into a physical theatre anytime soon, but I think we're going to do another online viewing of it, because it was quite popular before. But who knows? You know, sometimes with these things, they might pop back up. I really want to do it in an actual club toilet. Like, I want to get Reese Lyons, the incredible actress. I want to get her in a club toilet. We use it as a way to, like, refund whatever club, like, has been facing some hardship, like an LGBT club, and we, like, produce it in a toilet in the club, and then we club after. That's what I'm, that's what, if it comes back, let's not have a fear, let's put it in an actual club.
Yeah, that would be really sick. That would definitely be cool. And you started off at the beginning talking about you want clubs to come back. What clubs are you excited about? Where do you want to be, like, at the end of a pandemic, when we've gotten through our social anxieties and are ready to get out again? where is the celebration going to be, basically? Like, is it in London? Like, what are you looking forward to with all of this?
I don't know if you found this, but, like, have you found yourself, like, yearning for, like, a different space to what you thought you, like, want to go back to?
I definitely, I mean, yes is the short answer to that. I mean, you know, I'm a DJ, and I have to say, it's a bit weird thinking about playing in a sweaty basement again, if I'm honest, considering there's just been so much space. And so, yeah, I definitely feel like it will be something maybe a little bit, I don't know, it still feels untangible, but I understand what you're saying. I think mainly kind of space. But also togetherness is kind of definitely, it's community that I miss in a big way, you know?
I keep on imagining being at Dalston Superstore on like on like a Friday night when like everyone's kind of on a Thursday night, and you know, all the, because Friday it gets a bit, you know, different kinds of crowds or whatever, a bit busier. Thursday night, have a really, really like sick night at Dawson Superstore, maybe like Babes are DJing, and then afterwards, you think you're gonna go to the afters, but actually you go to the K-hole next door, the karaoke bar, and you do a spin. You do a spin there, and then, dare I say it, like, look, this is on camera, so people are gonna read me for this, but like, I'm craving a trip at Adonis. Like, I don't frequent there a lot anymore, but I don't know why I'm kind of feeling it. I'm feeling, I want that trip.
Well, you know what? I got a Facebook invite for one of those, so it's back.
Oh my God.
I can do a Sharesy, babes, don't you worry.
Yes, exactly, exactly. But it's a festival. Like, so I think I'm craving a festival because not last year, obviously, when whatever year was the last time we had a summer without COVID, I said no to so many festivals. I was like, no, I'm not going up to do a panel for 40 minutes and then camping out. No. Like, I just want a relaxing time. And now all I'm thinking about is, why have I ever said no to doing a weekend at a festival? I'm never saying no ever again. So I want to be at Glastow, you know, I want to go back to Boomtown, all of that.
Boomtown, okay. We're getting serious.
I said Katie B dropped in the chat earlier, we're going Boomtown.
And what's next for you as an artist? Did you know, where are your thoughts and feelings and where do you think your work might take you next? Sort of metaphorically.
Yeah, well, I think I'm just starting out, you know, I'm just getting into it and I'm just kind of finding my feet. I feel like after Burgers, it was the first time I took myself seriously and like intentional and like as someone that could do this. Like, it sounds silly, but before Burgers, I was working as an artist and people were calling me one, but I didn't really believe that it was like my job. And so I feel like really new. And so I'm just looking forward to writing more, making more shows, dreaming stuff up. You know, I have hopes and dreams to write a TV show. I want to like make the kind of stories, but I want them to be on loads of homes across the UK. Stories that feel like really distinctly set in the UK as well. Like, I feel like there's not a lot of trans, gender non-conforming stories that are not in the US. And I want to show us as less of educational points and more as like complex people. So yeah, just more stories that are doing that, I hope.
Wonderful, and I can't wait to see them for sure. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed talking to you, and it's been lovely to meet, even if it is over Zoom. It has
so nice.
And I'm definitely going to continue coming to, you know, watch everything you put on.
I want to come to the next DJ set you do. So swapsies.
Sure. Awesome. Well, this is Classic Album Sunday, so we would love to encourage you to listen to Is Your Love Big Enough in its fullness, and take some time, you know, switch off your computer, switch off your phone, and just really enjoy and soak up Lianne La Havas' debut album. We'll be back next Sunday, and thank you to Arts Council England for making this all possible. Thank you and good night.